cause the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came to me and brought the victory. Victory, yeah, Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me.
Before you, claiming the victory that is ours in the name of Jesus. There is no other name higher. We yield ourselves to you this moment, this place. For all of those sitting at home, lounged out in their pajamas, Father, those that are perked up and listening and dancing in their living rooms, Father, may your peace and victory settle upon each and every one. We come before you with thanksgiving, with praise, with adoration. Our heart's desire is to lift you high this very morning, to glorify you, to say that you are our God. In you there is victory. We stake our claim upon you. Father, when the day comes for us to be gathered up into our mansions, Father, remember us. Bring us into your presence. For we stake our claim and our belief in the name of Jesus, his name. Amen. All right, this morning.
You guys don't have anything to
do. All right. This morning, we're going to put in the doghouse. We got Mr. Jim Persantes in the doghouse this morning. And it kind of just fell that it also happens to be his birthday. Mr. Persante, happy birthday to you, Jim. I'm hoping you're celebrating well and maybe you got your family around. And he'd be the guy that would be, you know, dancing around the living room in his pajamas, you know, celebrating his birthday. And so we're just dancing with you, Jim. Love you, man. Miss you. If you don't know much about Jim, he's a master electrician and has been assistant treasurer here for a decade or so at New Life Alliance Church. Just a humble servant of God. And Father, everybody, we just thank him. We thank the Lord for him and pray that each and every one of you would continue to think of him this week and pray for him. Let's pray for him right now as he celebrates, and I see the big number up there. I don't know, does he even want me to say 60? I wouldn't probably want anybody to say he was 60. I probably won't say that he's turning the big 6-0 right now. So. Jim, let's pray for my brother. Father in heaven, we just come before you with thanksgiving and praise for our dear brother. Father, what a dear man, what a dear friend. I thank you for what he means to me personally, Father, and I know what he means to your kingdom. And Father, I'd pray that you would continue the good works that you've begun in his life, Father. Continue to mold him, shape him. And Father, the bonds that exist between him and his wife, Barbara, Father, just they may continue to flourish, grow, and strengthen. And Father, that there would be love and respect in that household. And Father, I would pray that your Spirit would continue to work in their lives in such a way as that they serve as a witness and a testimony to anyone that would observe. And Father, for the family and friends that are around them, Father, and even co-workers for Jim, Father, and Barbara as well, Father, I just pray your blessing upon them. May your light live in them, and may your light shine through them. We uphold them before you. Look forward to all that you're going to do in them, with them, and through them. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. Happy birthday, Jim. God bless you. Hey, check this out.
Our final one on tithing. And this time it's not just for the kids, it's for the whole family. So pay close attention. All right. First of all, did you know that the first time we see tithing in the Bible was with Abraham? Yes, that many thousands of years ago. Abraham knew that God doesn't actually need anything because he made everything, but he wanted to honor God. So what he did was he gave 10% to Melchizedek, who was a most favored, most beloved high priest of the Most High God at that time. So it's been around a bit. So this is nothing new. Someone asked me one time, if we don't tithe, does his mercy and grace end? No, he loves us. He wants us to have what we need. But how much better off are we if we trust him? It opens the door for God to bless us even more. Let's look at what happens when our faith is shaky, when we get rattled and don't let God take control. So, here we are, making some money, living paycheck to paycheck, with more bills than money. What's happening? Nothing. We're struggling. We're stuck with what we have. No more, no less. All right? But what happens when we let Jesus into our hearts? What happens when we open that door and start to have faith in him? Let's find out. Suddenly, we see the blessings start to come. We see mercy and grace more abundantly. Isn't that awesome? But then, something happens. We don't trust him with our finances. We're literally limiting God's effectiveness in our lives. The reaction is still taking place. There's still blessings and mercy and grace. But it can only go so far because you're not allowing God. You are blocking God from blessing you abundantly. He loves us and is concerned with all aspects of our lives. Well, that was fun right there. I'm glad I didn't break it. Okay. It takes a lot of faith to give God the first 10%. Even before you see if you're going to have enough for food, for bills, or for whatever, by tithing, we are telling God, thank you for 100% of everything I have. I honor you with 10% of my income because I trust you to supply all my needs 100%. All right, that is what tithing is. It's not about giving money to the church. It's not about giving money to your favorite charity. It's about trusting God with everything that you have. Now, what would those blessings look like if you really trusted God? If you honored him by tithing, even when it's scary and nerve-wracking because you have no idea how to make ends meet, even when your account is already in the negative and your paycheck goes in and sucks away a third of it, speaking from experience, how can you get on top of this and let God take control? We're going to find out. First of all, in Luke 6:38, Jesus says, give, and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So we're going to see what that looks like. All right? So here we go again. Earning money. We got what we got. No more, no less. Stuck again. Okay? We now have Jesus in our hearts, saving us from ourselves, from our sin. Soap. Oh, remember the soap lesson? Work. So then we're going to pray. We're going to ask God to please help us. Tell us what we can do. Tell us what we can give. Help us get to where we can start tithing that 10%. By the way, guys, safety goggles with all chemical experiments. So now we're going to see Luke 6, verse 38 in action. All right? You're going to have a good measure. You're going to press it down. You're going to shake it together. And next thing you know, your blessings will be running over and pouring into your lap nonstop. It's working so good. We're just going to keep it inside the dish there. So that's it, guys. This concludes the unit on tithing. I don't think I could make this any clearer as to what could happen. We've tithed, we've given offerings from the bottom of our heart, speaking to the Holy Spirit, and your lives will be completely changed and turned around. I'm not going to promise that. God promises that. This is Miss Lydia signing off.
Wow, thank you, Lydia. That was awesome. That was a really good video. But now I will be doing the scripture reading of 2 Corinthians 2, the New International Version, NIV for short. And we'll start at verse 1. So I made up my mind that I would not make another painful visit to you. For if I grieve you, who is left to make me glad but you whom I have grieved? I wrote as I did so that when I came, I would not be distressed by those who should have made me rejoice. I had confidence in all of you, that you would all share my joy, for I wrote you out of great distress and anguish of heart, and with many tears, not to grieve you, but to let you know the depth of my love for you. If anyone has caused grief, he has not so much grieved me as he has grieved all of you to some extent, not to put it too severely. The punishment inflicted on him by the majority is sufficient. Now instead, you ought to forgive and comfort him, so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for him. Another reason I wrote you was to see if you would stand the test and be obedient in everything. Anyone you forgive, I also forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there was anything to forgive, I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake, in order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. Now when I went to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ and found that the Lord had opened a door for me, I still had no peace of mind because I did not find my brother Titus there. So I said goodbye to them and went on to Macedonia. But thanks be to God, who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. To the one we are an aroma that brings death, to the other an aroma that brings life. And who is equal to such a task? Unlike so many, we do not peddle the word of God for profit. On the contrary, in Christ we speak before God with sincerity, as those sent from God. Amen.
Thank you, Jeff. I appreciate that, brother. Am I coming through over there? You can kind of hear me okay? All right, good. Thank you. So I just want to make sure that we're having communion as well today, celebrating together as a family. So if you haven't yet, you can prepare, if you wouldn't mind, maybe some juice, some bread or crackers or something of that nature. And well, after the message, we'll sing some songs and we'll go into communion. So I just want to make sure that we're all prepared for that and doesn't catch you off guard. So feel free while the pastor's preaching to do what's necessary to maybe prepare the elements. So we're continuing in our study with the Corinthian church, 2 Corinthians and chapter 2. Right out of the gate, it's pretty obvious that Paul's grieving over this congregation. His last visit there is very painful, causing him much grief. In fact, verse 1, so I made up my mind, he writes, I would not make another painful visit to you. Paul's ministry to that church is difficult, to say the least, challenging on many fronts and on many levels. That fellowship and in that city, it's a very corrupt city, morally bankrupt, lots of negativity that is outside the church that is now filtering and falling into the church, and many differing styles of beliefs. Paul continues to deal with problem after problem after problem. This isn't just he writes a letter and things are solved and things go away and everybody falls into place. This is time after time after time, situation after situation after situation. Even his own authority comes into question about dealing with the situations. So he's facing a lot of adversity and a lot of opposition. And there's your first one. For those that like to take notes, it's adversity and opposition. There will be times in your life when you will face adversity and opposition. Maybe right now you feel sequestered in your homes, that you're feeling very isolated, very opposed, even right now feeling a lot of frustration and adversity. Physically, maybe adverse. Emotionally, not quite there. Maybe even spiritually you feel that there's an oppression in your house or that's taking place. And what's really challenging, at least what cracks my brain open, if I can say it that way, is when it comes to that adversity, when the adversity comes from your brothers in Christ, when it comes from your sisters in Christ, when it comes from those that are within the fellowship, that's even a little bit more anxiousness. It would seem that those that would want to walk with you and care for you and love you and be alongside you in the walk would be those that would be the most encouraging and comforting and loving, but oftentimes there's differing opinions, differing methods, different programs. I'm going to follow Apollo. I'm going to follow Paul. I'm going to follow Peter. And oftentimes it just becomes very destructive within the body. See, I can understand the world being opposing. I can understand the world giving adversity. But oftentimes it's right within the church. People that claim Christ as their Savior battling themselves. That causes a lot of pain and a lot of grief and deep, deep heartbreak. And I started to think about that a little bit more. That deep heartache. Many of us know what that is. Many of us know what that is to feel like that from people within the fellowship of brothers and sisters in Christ. And as I pondered that a little bit more, it really became clear that it truly is the ones that are the closest to you that can hurt you the deepest. Because the ones that are not that close to you don't seem to hurt you that much. See, I can remember someone trying to give me an insult or insulting me in some way. You know, Pastor, I don't like your shirt, or your shoes are kind of funny looking, or those are weird pants you're wearing today, trying to give me an insult. And really, at those points, I didn't know what to say other than, you know, I really have to care about what you say for you to insult me. It's what we hold in value. It's who we hold up in value. It's what we place meaning upon. It's what we give worth to that can cause us great grief and great pain. Of course, you make yourself vulnerable to that. It's the only way you could ever find true love and true harmony and true peace is to make yourself vulnerable to be hurt that deeply. And it is those that you admire and respect that can cause such tremendous pain. See, the death of a mom and dad doesn't, you know, whoever mom and dad it is, doesn't always cause hurt until it's your mom and dad. Then when it's your mom and dad, it hits home. It's close. It hurts. It's real. And that's the grieving process, really, that Paul's experiencing here. He's hurting over the body. He's hurting over those that are within the Corinthian church. He's hurting within that congregation. Why? Because they're close to him. It's not as if he doesn't care. He cares deeply. He cares and he loves them. For I wrote you, he's writing, I wrote you out of great distress. I wrote you out of great anguish in my heart with many tears. Could see him writing with tears streaming down his face. I'm writing not to grieve you, not to hurt you, but to let you know the depth of love that I hold for you. A pastor's heart crying out, I wish you knew the peace. He's writing many times to challenge them. He's guiding them. He's reprimanding them. He's confronting them. Not to insult them, but to transform them. To give them opportunity and things to think about. Proverbs would kind of say it this way, wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies his kisses. Honestly, loving someone and speaking the truth in love is showing concern for them. Here's a slide that says this one, is it better to be hurt with the truth than comforted with a lie? We talked a lot about comfort last week. Would you rather be comforted with the lie or spoken the truth? I can't even begin to tell you how many times I've challenged people in their walks with God. Some receive it, some fight it, and some curse at me and walk away. And it falls right back to where that other statement was made. It's like, well, you don't have any value, you don't hold any meaning, you don't, so whatever you're saying to me is pointless and meaningless, and I don't place any merit upon it, so they don't receive it. See, many people don't like that you know them too well. This is kind of why I think you know, big mega churches, you know, people just come in and go out. They don't really even know many people well. If they can get house churches and family churches and cell groups and small groups, this is where you start to know people. You get to know them like family. And it's really family who knows you the best, isn't it? And family can hurt you. We're vulnerable to them. And listen, we are often disappointed by them. And we often disappoint them. And that's family. The ones that are closest to you know you and love you. And family can make you better. The Corinthian church is an open book at this point. They're pretty transparent. They've been writing questions and asking and all kinds of scenarios, particularly from 1 Corinthians. And then Paul's giving his testimony about his own hurts and his own thought processes about what's taking place. And that church is, and that fellowship is asking a lot of questions. Are you asking a lot of questions? It's good to ask a lot of questions, not about somebody else, but about yourself. Don't be afraid. You can step into the light, and the fear goes away. You can trust the Lord, and the guilt that is holding on to you will diminish. With repentance in your heart, love takes over. Family opens their arms and receives. You can begin to dog them as we're supposed to. Problem starts to arise when we land on judgment. Can you walk with people that think differently than you? Can you walk with people that vote differently than you? Can you walk with people that dress differently than you? Paul and the Corinthian church here, they're having troubles. They're having issues. And the issues are not, you know, with a leaky roof. The issues are not with, you know, the color of the walls. The issues are not that another air conditioning unit didn't work or they can't get the windows open. No, the issues are people. The problems within the church are people. People that are struggling, people that are hurting. People that are trying to survive, people that are trying to find a walk with strong opinion. Now, instead, this is Paul writing, verse 7, you ought to forgive and comfort. I like the way he says this. It's important we bring this out. Now, instead, you ought to forgive and comfort him so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for him. Another reason I wrote. So he has another reason for writing. He's writing again. The another reason that I wrote is to see if you would even stand the test of obedience to do these things that are of the Lord, that are God's ways. Another reason I wrote is to see if you would stand the test and be obedient in everything. Anyone you forgive, I will also forgive. And what I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake. In order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. Satan thrives in the realm of unforgiveness. I'll say it again. Satan thrives in the realm of unforgiveness. Don't let the enemy get a foothold. So there's forgiveness and resolution. There's your next one. Forgiveness and resolution. So whoever Paul's talking about, instead you ought to forgive and comfort him so that he might not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. Whomever he's directing this to has caused a lot of conflict within the body. Perhaps it's the guy that we read about in 1 Corinthians, you know, that had all that immorality going on in his household. Perhaps it's the outspoken brother who keeps continuing to challenge Paul and his authority and continues to bring it up. Perhaps it's the women in the church that continue to interrupt the order of service of things. Whoever it is, forgiveness has to be given. Healing has to begin. Restoration needs to take place. And Paul is concerned about the other person. He's concerned about whoever that is, that the body may be treating them unfairly, overpunished, if you will. the offender. He's trying to reconcile the very one that has been causing all the pain and all the sorrow and all the grief, and perhaps very personally to Paul, the one that has been causing him the pain and causing him the irritation. He's saying, we must forgive. We must resolve. Doesn't that sound just like Jesus? Concerned over those that would bring offense. Concerned over you that has offended God so much. See, if you find yourself in a place you're holding on to resentment and unforgiveness, wanting to punish, rebuke, chastise, reprimand, discipline, judge, ultimately you're hurting yourself. You drink the poison and hope the other person dies. We love to judge, don't we? We just love to judge. You know, with too many tattoos, the hair's not cut right, you know, wearing the wrong clothes, too young, too old, wrong church, reading the wrong Bible, don't go to the right places, do the wrong things. We just love to sit back and judge. For whatever reason, if it elevates us or if it just knocks them down, try grace and forgiveness. Instead of the first impression always being judge, how about the first impression being grace? We often walk into circumstances and situations, you know, with all the skepticism. We already have all our walls up because we're afraid of being hurt and vulnerable. Put the walls down. Let the light of Christ speak. Far too often, Christians love to punish repentant sinners far more than God ever would. Isn't that crazy? And far too often, listen carefully, far too often we punish ourselves more than God ever would. That'd probably be more where I'm at. I'm more of a self-punisher because I recognize how lowly I am and how difficult I can be and how hurtful I can be and all the darkness that's inside of me and the flesh. I would have a tendency to beat myself up more than God probably ever would. And we'll read in a few short chapters from now, we'll read about how this letter starts to bring a reconciliation and a forgiveness into the congregation. And the reason that that is because they don't just hear the word, they do what it says. Isn't that amazing? That's out of James. So they're taking this letter and they're placing some authority and merit upon it, and then they're going to try to do what it says. They're going to try to live that life. They're going to try to tithe even though it's very difficult. They're going to try to exercise grace even though it's very difficult. They're going to try to not judge but live in peace even though it's very difficult. It goes against everything that the flesh wants because the flesh is rebelling against God. But then the Holy Spirit is able to work and minister. And so the real questions become, are you doing what you're knowing? Everybody tuning in and listening and trying to get the word of God. Well, you get it, but do you do it? You receive it, but do you put it into practice? Are you walking what you're talking? See, if you don't practice what you preach, you need to change your speech. But in the midst of all of this, confrontation is necessary. The conflict brings about change. Challenges bring about growth and spiritual depth. So oftentimes people are praying, dear God, help me, I want to go spiritually deeper. So he brings you a conflict, but you don't resolve it correctly. You don't handle it properly. I wrote you also to see if you would be obedient in everything. Concerning your finances, concerning your emotions, concerning your physical well-being, concerning your spiritual direction in your life and how you handle and hold relationships. See, if you feel challenged right now, good. If you feel that there are some changes that need to take place, some changes within yourself, good. If you've been experiencing conflict maybe while you're in tight quarters with those that are the family, ones that can hurt you the most, good. Here's the chance. Here's the opportunity. Here's the break that you've been looking for. And many times, it's the answer to your prayers, but you don't recognize it. I want you to recognize it. Here's the opportunity to exercise your faith, to get some spiritual muscle, so to speak, like from last week. We talked about that. Exercise your patience, exercise kindness, exercise grace, exercise mercy, exercise forgiveness and love. Here's the opportunity. There are two mistakes often that are made within the family and within the family of the church as well, within the congregation and the body of believers. One is being too lenient. One is being too lenient. There's no correcting of mistakes. Everything is fine. Let everything slide. There's no problem. Sin runs rampant. Oh, it's okay. We're all sinners. Disrespecting your husband. Well, it's a non-issue. God forgives us. Bad-mouthing your church. Oh, I understand. You know, all the churches aren't the same. Degrading your children. Everybody's a sinner. You can be too lenient. Just acceptance of everything. And all sin comes in. It's not a house of God. It's a house of ill repute and sinfulness. No one's interested in transforming. We're all interested in just exercising whatever comes their way and exercising the ways of the flesh. You can be too lenient. The other side is, you can guess it, you can be too harsh. You can be too legalistic. You can never forgive people. You can go to the other extreme. Everything's okay. And then you say, nothing's okay. You're banished from my sight, you sinner. I can't believe you would say that you're a born-again Christian and then you do the things that you do. I banish you. I shun you. I'm never talking to you again. I can't even look at you as a Christian anymore. You can be too harsh. See, here's a slide for you. There's a time to confront, and there's a time to forgive. And you could stay on that slide if you would. There's a time to confront, and there's a time to forgive. Let's do this when we exercise a little bit of forgiveness. Give me that next slide. Forgive others as quickly as you expect God to forgive you. See, often within our own family, there's a lot of things happening on two different fronts, many times. And trying to get people to go from being too lenient to somewhere balanced, or too harsh and too legalistic to somewhere balanced. This is a work that's always in progress. Because oftentimes we seem to waver one side or the other. We do this with ourselves as well. We don't dare pass judgment upon ourselves unless we hurt ourselves too much. But we give reasons and justifications, and we waver one way or even the other. See, often within a family, one is celebrating a birth, and the other is mourning a death. And we walk together. One family celebrating a graduation. Another is troubled because their child is going to jail. And yet we walk together. One family's filled with joy as there's a profession of faith and someone's going to get baptized. And one family is struggling because there's alcoholism and addiction wreaking havoc in their homes. And what do? We walk together. This is what we do. We walk together. Trying to not go one extreme or go to the other extreme, but we walk together. And oftentimes it's all happening at the same time. We will continue to walk as a family. We will continue to hope as a family. We will continue to celebrate as a family. Whether we're praying together on Sundays or whether we're meeting for a Zoom prayer on a Thursday, we're doing this together as a family. Somebody say together. Just so that I know that you're even listening out there, why don't somebody text together. Together. We walk together. We're doing all this by staying, you know, connected through emails, through texts. We're often trying to put up on Facebook and broadcast so that we can stay connected. And listen, we do not want to be unaware of Satan's schemes. The enemy wants to rip the church apart. The enemy wants to divide the family. The enemy wants to keep us isolated and disconnected. But we're doing our best to try to keep connected. The enemy will want you drowning in your fear. Can I say this to you? Limit your TV watching. Limit your TV watching. Watch the news in the morning and the evening. Let it go. You'll catch everything that's going on. You'll catch all the changes. They're not updating us that fast. Eliminate a lot of what you're putting into your brain. Put on a song and dance around your living room like Jim Prasante and it's your birthday. Enjoy a little bit of the presence of the Lord in your life. The enemy wants us to be living in fear. The enemy wants us cowered over in the corner. The enemy wants us confused. The enemy wants us depressed. The enemy wants us miserable and sad. And the enemy wants us judging everything, criticizing everyone. Don't give Satan a foothold. You stand strong. You walk in your faith. You walk in your hope. You are not alone. And are you ready? Maybe you want to write this one down. I should have put it up on a slide for you. You can write this down. You are essential to the kingdom of God. You are essential to the kingdom of God. Don't let anyone else talk you out of that. You're essential to his family. You're essential to the body of Christ. You're essential to this congregation and to this church if you come here and belong here and listen. You're essential to me if I know you by name. And see, I'm so glad that our family is so much more than a church building. Haven't we proven that? That's amazing that we're so much more than a church building. We're so much more than meeting for an hour on Sunday. We have lived for decades like this, going way beyond Sunday and just being together on Sunday gatherings. We have prayed together. We have cried together. We have worked together. We've cared for each other. We've celebrated together. And we soap together. One of the greatest things you could possibly do is still being connected to this church even while you're at home is to soap the scripture. I'm preaching on 2 Corinthians chapter 3 next Sunday. Join us. And by the way, this week, will you read 2 Corinthians chapter 3 as a way to stay united in the church fellowship and with the church body. And we'll probably even have a prayer Zoom meeting if you want to come in and join us on Thursday. But the least you could do, please, open your Bible. Look it up on your phone, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and we'll preach on it. We are united and we are together. And in the midst of still being united and together comes this covenant continuation. Here's your next one. Covenant continuation. See, even in the midst of what Paul's dealing with within the Corinthian church, and even in the midst of us being isolated and sequestered in our homes, even in the midst of adversity and opposition, challenges, confrontation, grief, Paul finds optimism. Paul finds optimism in all of this. And we should find optimism and hope as well, for this too shall pass. We have a hope that is bigger than this world. We have a Savior that overcomes disease. We have a Christ that conquered both sin and death. There's this continuation of the covenant of God. It's not stopped by government. It's not stopped by virus. It's not stopped by war. But thanks be to God, Paul writes, who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere. So that's, I can look at that and go, what? What? I don't, thanks be to God who always leads us as captives. So he's leading us as a captive in a triumphal procession. What does that even mean? I'm held captive in a triumphal procession. For we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. See, we're marching forward. We're marching in victory. We're marching in triumph. And man, do you smell. See, when the Romans returned from a gallant war effort, they came back in a parade. They came back in a triumphal, right, parade, conquering the land. They came through right down Main Street, heading for the castle. They paraded all the treasures. They paraded all the jewels, all the keepsakes for all to see. Now, those that are the Romans are cheering. Hallelujah, victory, praise be to God. What a sweet smell of victory. And to those that are held captive, slavery. It smells of death. They are now imprisoned. That's Paul parading us right down Main Street. And man, do you smell. You smell the aroma of Christ upon you, or smell the aroma of death. For indeed, Christ is leading a victorious parade. Same parade, different view. Same parade, different smell. We're in a parade right now. Some of you are walking in victory with the Lord Jesus Christ. Others are being held captive by Satan. Some give off the sweet aroma of Jesus. Others reek of Hades. Same parade. Some latch on to the risen Jesus, some still drowning in the pits of hell in despair. Here's your chance. Here's your chance to escape the chains of darkness, to escape the binds that hold you in damnation. This is your opportunity. Accept the invitation. Pray to receive Jesus Christ and be part of his family. Would you pray with me now? Pray with me now. Just like this, within your heart. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you. I believe your Son died for my sins. I believe he rose again. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. And remember me in your parade of victory. In the name of your Son, I pray. Amen. Maybe that's the first time you've ever prayed that. Maybe it's the thousandth time you've ever prayed that. But the recognition that you are one of Jesus' own. One of the first things and the best things you can do to lay claim and to stake claim that you are one of Jesus is to have communion. So what we're going to do with communion is we're going to gather around, we're going to sing a couple songs, we'll partake of the elements together. And here's really kind of what I'm hoping for. I'm really kind of hoping that you would join us in just a moment of relaxation. That you can get everybody around, you know, and just be in the moment. That it's really not about whether we sing the right song, or it's not about whether we play the right chord, it's not about whether we even sound good or not, it's about whether you have the heart for Christ right where you are, and that you would seek him. Try to eliminate some of the distractions that are around you. And just take the moment to say, I want to have communion with my family. I want to be a part. I want to be in this parade. So we'll take communion together, we'll worship together, and we'll sing some songs together. So, if you haven't yet, let's prepare our hearts for communion. Hey, take a look at this.
Thank you.
little Amazing Grace. Come on, now you know it. Join it with us. Come on. Jeff?
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed.
Oh, let's give Jess a little something here. Come on, Jess, sing it for her.
Cling to the old rugged cross.
cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left His glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. And He'll call me someday my home far away, where His glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange someday for a crown.
Amen. And on that old rugged cross, our God, Jesus Christ, took the punishment for us. Took the pain for our sin. We will choose this moment now to remember that. On that night that He was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Partake in remembrance of me." And so right now, Jess will pray a blessing over the bread, and we shall partake together.
Father in heaven, we give you the praise and the glory. Awesome are you. Thank you, Father, for this beautiful Lord's Day. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity that we have to continue to preach the gospel even into the homes, Lord. Father, all of this is possible because we do have a mighty, awesome God, a loving God. And we have a Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, that took it upon Himself to surrender His body upon that cross. Father, He surrendered that body in much pain, but yet, God, within there was much joy, because that's who He is, a suffering Christ for the joy of His people. So, Father, we thank you. Jesus, we thank you for surrendering that body upon the cross. For each and every one, in Jesus' name.
Let us partake the bread together, church. Also, on the night he took the cup and said, "This is my blood shed for you. Partake in remembrance of me." Stan, would you pray a blessing over the blood?
Oh, absolutely. Heavenly Father, in redeeming sacrifice, you shed your blood for the forgiveness of our sins.
Thank you, Father.
We are so very grateful. You are our ransom. You took our place. You are our advocate. The punishment that should have been mine was upon you. And you gladly bore it. You took it. And I thank you for paving the way, setting a path that I might be reconciled to God. Because through your blood, we offer this thanksgiving in remembrance of you.
Let us partake together. Continue in worship.
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power in thine alone. Can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed in white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Yes, Lord, thank you, Jesus.
And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Oh, I can sing that again.
Let's sing it again.
Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Yes.
Thank you. Just right where you are, just give him thanks and praise.
Amen.
What are you thankful for, Father? I thank you for your provision. I thank you for your salvation. As well with your soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, should buffet, though trials should come, lest this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my head shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross. And I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well with
The point.